Caesar was at Ravenna with one veteran legion when he received the news of the Senate's decision. He decided, most likely on January 10th, to invade Italy and did so with lightning speed. He immediately took Ariminum and Arretium and continued with his invasion. News of Caesar's invasion did not reach Rome until January 17th, which surprised and demoralized everyone. The Senate believed that Pompey's legions in Italy would prevent Caesar from invading so quickly. And Cato was genuinely shocked that Caesar decided to invade. The other optimates, working alongside Cato, most likely knew that their efforts would push Caesar to war, but Cato genuinely did not believe that would happen. Plutarch writes, "But from that day, as we are told, Cato neither cut his hair nor trimmed his beard, nor put on a garland, but maintained the same mien of sorrow, dejection, and heaviness of spirit in view of the calamities of his country, alike in victory and in defeat, until the end." In the face of Cato's miscalculations, he would soon be saying that peace was worth giving Caesar what he wanted, and he would work to preserve the lives of his fellow Romans. Despite his personal feelings, Cato preserved his famous determination and uncompromising nature, and carried out every responsibility given to him to the best of his ability, and he would hold out longer than any of Pompey's other allies. Pompey had once boasted that all he had to do was stomp his feet on the ground, and legions would spring up to serve him. When the Senate received the news of Caesar's invasion, Cato's ally and imitator, Favonius, taunted Pompey by telling him to start stomping. Cato, on the other hand, simply reminded Pompey that he warned him of the danger of Caesar. Although Pompey was unprepared, he still had a good plan. He ordered the evacuation of Rome, and if he had to, he would evacuate Italy as well. This was a strategically sound plan. His tactical retreat would buy him enough time to bring his legions over from Spain and from the east, and with the control of the Roman navy, he could contain Caesar in Italy. However, the evacuation of Rome weighed heavily on the optimates, and they blamed Pompey for not being able to stop Caesar. Motivated by his success, Caesar continued trying to negotiate with Pompey in the Senate. On January 23rd, he basically accepted the Senate's resolution of January 1st. He was willing to lay down his legions and provinces, and to set aside the law of the 10 tribunes and run for the consulship in person, giving up his right to stand in absentia. His only demands were for Pompey to dismiss his legions and take up personal command of his province in Spain, and for the Senate to rescind its ultimate decree. Caesar was giving everything the Senate was asking for, and this would have been a significant victory if the Senate had accepted it. But they didn't. If Cato, however, had been solely in charge, things might have turned out differently. Cato most likely would have accepted these terms. Cicero wrote about Cato's call for peace, that peace was preferable to war, and Cato insisted on being there when peace talks were being negotiated. Cicero writes, "On arriving at Capua yesterday, the 25th, I met the consuls and many members of the Senate. They were all hoping that Caesar would withdraw his garrisons and stand by the terms he had proposed, all except Favonius, who did not approve of letting Caesar dictate conditions to us. But he got no hearing in the conclave. Even Cato now prefers slavery to war. However, he says he wants to be present in the Senate when the terms are debated, if Caesar is induced to withdraw his garrisons. So he does not trouble about going to Sicily, where his presence is urgently needed, but he wants to be in the Senate, where I'm afraid it will be in the way." Postumius, who was specifically directed by the Senate to proceed immediately to Sicily and take over from Fafanus, refuses to go without Cato. The fact that Favonius, the infamous Cato imitator, maintained his Catonian stance shows us just how far Cato had drifted from his traditional mannerisms. He was not willing to stake the Republic on bringing Caesar to justice, and further highlights his surprise that civil war had come. He wanted to be there when the terms were discussed so that he could exert his influence, but by this point, he most likely did not have much sway over the war council. Pompey and the optimates refused to take any step until Caesar had removed himself and his army from Italy. This is because Pompey and the optimates, including Cicero, believed Caesar could be beaten. The original terms of January 1st were no longer acceptable, and Caesar understood this and continued his invasion. After the war had broken out, Cato and Pompey became allies. This is because Cato saw Pompey as the Republic's best choice in defeating Caesar. With this new alliance, Cato urged the Senate to give Pompey supreme military authority, but further signs of Cato's loss of control within the Senate shows, when the Senate rejected Cato's demand and instead dished out commands to those within the Senate who still held Imperium. This was a disastrous move, because many optimates refused to listen to Pompey. For example, the consul Lentulus failed to carry out Pompey's instructions regarding the transportation of the treasury, and as a result, the entire treasury fell into the hands of Caesar, who was now able to pay and supply his soldiers. Another example is Domitius Ahenobarbus. He refused to listen to Pompey's orders to take his fresh recruits south to rendezvous with Pompey at Brundisium, and thought it was a good idea to take on Caesar and his veteran legion. Domitius was soon trapped and defeated, captured by Caesar. He was released to fight another day, but his troops stayed and joined Caesar. As a result, Pompey was forced to abandon Italy. While Cato was calling for peace, he also urged Pompey, in the words of Plutarch, not to plunder a city that was subject to Rome, and not to put a Roman to death except on the field of battle. But Pompey and the Optimus ignored this, threatening cities and towns throughout Italy that they would be treated as enemies unless they pledged loyalty to Pompey and the Optimates. Not only that, but many of the Optimates were using the excuse of civil war to enrich themselves by pillaging their fellow Romans. No doubt Cato was appalled by this. Pompey originally wanted to send Cicero to control Sicily as part of the plan to entrap Caesar, but Cicero declined, and so Cato was sent instead. However, once Domitius lost his army, entrapment became impossible. Pompey may have sent Cato to Sicily as a way of getting rid of him. He and Cicero's constant talk of peace may have been irksome to the war effort, and neither of them were military men, but that doesn't mean that Sicily wasn't an important role. Cato's organizational skills would have no doubt been put to good use in Sicily, since Rome relied heavily on the grain shipments from the island. However, Pompey seems to have given little thought to Cato once he was gone. Cato received very little aid while in Sicily, and wasn't recalled after Domitius' defeat ruined the entrapment strategy, and he doesn't seem to be highly valued once he joined Pompey in Greece. Cato left for Sicily with 12 slaves, which was a poor entourage compared to the other senators, and he left with very little money, such that he had to borrow from Lucullus' son later on in Greece. As soon as Cato arrives in Sicily, he begins repairing old warships and requisitioning new ones, as well as recruiting both infantry and cavalry. While doing this, Caesar's legate Asinius Pollio lands on the island at Messana with an advanced force. Cato responded to this news by dispatching a letter to Pollio, asking him about his legal authority to be on the island. This is a strange thing to ask your enemy during a civil war. Cato was most likely prepared to defend the island against Pollio, but once he heard that Curio was coming with a larger army, Cato abandoned Sicily on April 23rd and told the inhabitants of Sicily to save themselves from bloodshed and join the winning side. Cato's abandonment of Sicily was a serious loss for Pompey because it meant that Pompey could no longer trap Caesar in Sicily as well as control the grain supply to Rome. Caesar will go on to take both Sicily and Sardinia as well as the naval ship stationed there, which gave him a strong position. This meant that the outcome of the civil war would be decided by the sword. Cicero blamed Cato for losing the island, but Cato's decision in the end might have been the best decision. Cato was no military commander, and rather than fighting a battle he might lose or hunkering down on a part of the island, he took his army and regrouped with Pompey at Dyrrachium. It is not known what kind of reception Cato received, but once he was with Pompey, he looked for ways to prolong an engagement, hoping that the civil war would be settled without bloodshed. Cato also continued to urge his fellow senators and Pompey not to pillage or kill any Roman except in battle, and with how the Optimates were already behaving, asking them not to pillage and enrich themselves most likely isolated Cato from the rest of them. When Cicero arrives at Dyrrachium, however, we see a shift in Cato's character. Cato actually scolded Cicero for joining the side of Pompey. Plutarch writes about this, writing, "Cato faulted Cicero greatly for siding with Pompey, for while it had not been morally possible for Cato to forsake the political order that he had embraced from the beginning, Cicero had unreasonably and unnecessarily made himself Caesar's enemy, and had come to them to share in such great danger, when he would have been more useful to his country and to his friends if, remaining neutral, he had adapted himself to events there." If this is accurate, this is a complete 180 of Cato's character, who bullied and harassed moderate senators for not being against Caesar. Now Cato is recognizing the fact that the Senate needed moderate senators like Cicero, and he's mad at Cicero because he believes Cicero should have been back in Italy trying to broker a peace. Cato's conscience may have been weighing heavily on him because of the consequences of his actions and those of his fellow allies. And it may be this reason that Pompey sends Cato to Asia Minor to aid in the collection of transport ships. But when he arrives, he was told by the local commanders that they had no need of him. So he left for Rhodes, where he will convince the inhabitants there to join Pompey, and he will leave behind his half-sister, Servilia, and her son, Bilucellus, there for their own protection. Once back at Dyrrachium, Plutarch will write that Pompey considered giving Cato command of his entire fleet, but instead he gave it to Bibulus, on the grounds that Cato would turn against Pompey once Caesar had been defeated. This is most likely untrue. If Pompey truly felt that Cato was a threat to him, he wouldn't have given Cato's close friend and brother-in-law, Bibulus, the command. Instead, what most likely happened is that Pompey offered Cato the command, but Cato declined it, instead saying that Bibulus should have it on grounds that Bibulus had a higher claim than he did, since Bibulus once held the rank of consul. Cato was kept at a distance by Pompey, most likely because Cato was a difficult ally and an unpredictable one. Before the Battle of Dyrrachium, which was an indecisive victory for Pompey, Cato was able to stir the hearts of his men better than any other commander, including Pompey himself. But after the battle, Cato lamented. He simply could not control himself at the sight of seeing so many of his fellow Romans killed by other Romans. While Pompey's army celebrated, Cato, in the words of Plutarch, was weeping for his country and bewailing the love of power that had brought such misfortune and destruction, as he saw that many brave citizens had fallen by one another's hands. Cato's lamenting in the moment of Pompey's much-needed victory shows us just how difficult he could be. Cato would soon be frowned upon for being the only senator to support Pompey's decision to display caution after the victory at Dyrrachium. Cato's support is consistent with his position of trying to stall as much as possible in the hopes that a peaceful resolution could be found. Cato abandoned Sicily rather than fight, and he will be absent at the Battle of Pharsalus and Thapsus. Furthermore, Cato was deeply disturbed by the prediction of a certain oarsman in the Rhodian fleet that Greece would be bathed in blood, Dyrrachium would be sacked, and the defenders would be forced to flee. Now, normally such a rumor wouldn't have bothered Cato, and this reflects what we have already been seeing, that this war deeply affected him, and perhaps even felt guilt over his role in causing the war. When Pompey went to face Caesar at Pharsalus, he left Cato in command of the camp at Dyrrachium. This is an important command, as Cato was in charge of 15 cohorts, and was assigned with protecting the army supply depot as well as defending the rear. But Pompey may have left him behind because he feared that Cato would turn on him once he defeats Caesar. Pompey was well aware that the Optimates were using him and that once they found no more use for him, they would turn on him like they had done in the past. Cato wasn't the only one left behind. Cicero and other senators were left behind too. At the Battle of Pharsalus on August 9th, 48 BC, Pompey was utterly defeated and his army routed. When news reached Cato and the others, Cato remained calm as others panicked, and he decided to move the camp to Corcyra to await any news from Pompey. There, Cato asked Cicero to take command of the Pompeian forces, either because Cicero was once a consul and held a higher claim than Cato, or because he felt Cicero was a more legitimate commander since he held Imperium. Cicero declined and was scolded by Pompey's hot-headed son, Gnaeus, but Cato intervened and allowed anyone who wanted to return back to Rome to do so. Almost a year ago, Cato was shouting to the Senate that all those who remain neutral would be treated as enemies, but now he's allowing anyone to go home, to quit the war. Cato mourned after the defeat of Pharsalus, choosing to eat sitting up rather than reclining, and would refuse to recline altogether unless to sleep. And while Pompey was alive, Cato would not abandon his men, and so he set forth to Egypt to follow Pompey. But when he received news of Pompey's murder by the king of Egypt, he changed the route to Cyrene, where he learned that Africa was still in control of one of Pompey's lieutenants, Attius Varus, and that Metellus Scipio had arrived there after the defeat of Pharsalus. After having to disembark his army and make a 7-day arduous journey to the province of Africa, of which Cato walked the entire journey at the head of his army, found Attius and Scipio fighting over who should lead the remaining Pompeian forces. They were also both appealing to the king of Numidia for support, which Cato despised to see two Roman commanders kowtowing before a foreign ruler. At their first meeting, Juba, the king of Numidia, placed his chair between Cato and Scipio, showing that he held superiority. But Cato moved his chair next to Scipio so that Scipio would be at the center. Afterward, Cato was able to reconcile the two commanders, who then asked Cato to lead the troops, but Cato refused, instead suggesting that Scipio lead the army, one because he held the consulship, two because the name Scipio would be better to inspire all the soldiers, and three, as we have already observed, Cato probably didn't want to lead any army. However, this was a mistake, because Scipio would end up making some critical mistakes that would cost him victory. Even though Scipio would command the army, Cato still had authority. He and Scipio managed to convince Pompey's son Gnaeus, who was with them in Africa, to go to Spain, which still leaned towards Pompey and to set up a stronghold there. And it is there that Gnaeus Pompey would assemble a powerful army that would nearly defeat Caesar at the Battle of Munda in 45. Cato maintained his stance on limiting Roman bloodshed. When Scipio wanted to massacre and raise the city of Utica to the ground for supporting Caesar, Cato managed to convince Scipio not to. As a result, Scipio placed Cato in charge of the city to be used as a supply depot, and Cato treated the inhabitants well. The only thing he did as a precaution was forcing those who supported Caesar to encamp outside the city walls. Cato also gathered the city's elite men and Pompeians and formed a new senate, and this operated similar to a republican government. Cato and Scipio had a year to prepare for Caesar's arrival, since Caesar would spend until 47 campaigning in the east. It was during this time Cato's disillusionment with the war grew, and he would become estranged from Scipio. He did not believe Scipio would behave with moderation if he was victorious over Caesar. Cato urged Scipio to avoid battle altogether, believing that they could starve Caesar into defeat. But Scipio disagreed, calling Cato a coward for hiding in Utica instead of fighting Caesar on the battlefield. Cato tried to clear this charge against him by saying that he would take his men and invade Italy. But Scipio thought that Cato was insincere, and as a result, Cato told his friends that war was hopeless, and that it did not matter who won because Cato would not return to Rome. You see, by this point, Cato's view of the Republic was that it was gone. The defenders of the Republic were no better than that of Caesar. Wherever Cato looked, nowhere was the Mos Maiorum to be found. Pompey was the only person that Cato thought could serve his cause, and he despised Pompey, and many times tried to have him politically destroyed. Since the Civil War broke out, Cato realized that no one ever really shared his vision of the Republic. In late December of 47, Caesar finally landed in Africa, and in January of 46, Caesar defeated his old legate Labienus. It would be many months before Caesar and Scipio would fight, and Cato urged Scipio to delay and let time weaken Caesar's army, but Scipio ignored it, and on April 6th, Cato received the news that Scipio had faced Caesar near Thapsus and fought a decisive battle. Scipio was utterly defeated and his army wiped out. Scipio himself, along with Jubed, survived and were sending letters to Cato to see what his next move was going to be. Cato briefly considered defending Utica, but thought that the inhabitants would go over to Caesar, so he told Scipio and Juba to forget about Utica and began evacuating the city. Caesar's relative, Lucius Caesar, was among the Pompeians at Utica and was going to lead an assembly to Caesar seeking mercy and pardons for himself and for all the Romans in Utica. Cato told his son to accompany Lucius Caesar and to seek mercy, but Cato refused to go or to have anyone else speak on his behalf. Cato had no intention of surrendering. Caesar would pardon Cato's son and would allow him to inherit his father's property, but Cato's son will die 4 years later alongside Brutus and Cassius at the Second Battle of Philippi. Cato knew that Caesar would pardon him, but he would rather die than receive his clemency. Dio writes about this, saying, "Cato himself, therefore, decided neither to war against Caesar, being unable to do so anyhow, nor yet go over to his side. This was not because of any fear, since he understood well that Caesar would be very eager to spare him for the sake of his reputation for humanity, but it was because he passionately loved freedom, and would not brook defeat at the hands of anybody, and regarded Caesar's pity as far more hateful than death." Cato also told his son before leaving that he should never engage in politics, and to seek mercy and live. Cato tells his son that for himself, he was raised and lived in a free republic, and that now it is not possible for him to live under Caesar's tyranny. But for his son, it was possible because he grew up under both conditions. Now, this summary was most likely created after his death to celebrate the ideal republican that Cato became in legend. But this also reflects his attitude since the war began. Cato probably saw no hope for regaining the republic. Cato, to the very end, carried out his responsibilities, leaving the citizens of Utica his remaining funds, along with his accounts and a careful record of his administration, and he continued to monitor the city's evacuation. With everything done, he began the preparations for his death. Now, there must be something noted about Cato's death, especially Plutarch's version of it. Cato's death is as much fiction as it is fact. Plutarch, who gives the most detailed account, was much more interested in the moral character of Cato and wanted to fit Cato into what Plutarch thought he represented. So Plutarch will end up linking Cato's death with Socrates, whose own death was known amongst educated readers. Cato bathed and afterwards took supper with a large company, sitting rather than reclining. Afterwards, they drank and discussed literary and philosophical subjects. Plutarch writes, "And one philosophical tenet after another made the rounds, until there came up the inquiry into what were called the paradoxes of the Stoics, namely that the good man alone is free and that the bad are all slaves." Here, as was to be expected, the Peripatetic made objections, whereupon Cato broke in with vehemence, and in loud and harsh tones maintained his argument at greatest length and with astonishing earnestness, so that everyone perceived that he had made up his mind to put an end to his life and free himself from his present troubles. At the end of the evening, Cato embraced his friends and son much longer than usual, and went to bed to read Plato's Phaedo, the philosophical dialogue set in the final hours of Socrates' life. While reading, he noticed his sword was missing, and when his slaves could not, or would not, produce it, he struck his slaves so hard he bruised his hand, yelling so loud that his son, who was crying, and his friends came running in, begging him not to kill himself. After Cato reassured them and received his sword, he read Phaedo a second time, falling asleep, and waking up around midnight. Once he heard all the ships were gone, he ordered his slaves to be on the lookout for returning ships in case of bad weather, and then went back into his room. It was there that he took his sword and stabbed himself in the stomach, but his aim was poor, and the blow was not immediately mortal. His son and friend heard the noise and ran into his room. Cato was unconscious, and so they summoned a doctor who stitched the wound, but Cato awoke in the middle of the operation and pushed the doctor away, ripping open his wound, tearing at his own organs until he died. The next day, Caesar arrived in Utica and was excited to pardon Cato, but was angry to have missed the opportunity. There could be no doubt that Caesar wanted to pardon Cato, but he honestly couldn't have been surprised when he heard Cato had committed suicide. Cato's suicide was a true Roman act and was seen as definitely praiseworthy, and months after his death, Cicero and Brutus were writing eulogies about him. From his suicide, Cato is bestowed the name Uticensis, marking the city of Utica, where he died. From his death, he is almost immediately deified as a Stoic philosopher. Cicero puts Cato's death in a Stoic mantle. Many Romans were interested in Stoic philosophy, but Cato after his death was set up to be the symbol of the lost republic. When Brutus and Cicero were writing eulogies for Cato, this angered Caesar, who felt the need to respond to Cicero with his own work called the Anticato, which is lost. Although Cato was dead, many Romans still looked favorably upon him, which vexed Caesar. In 46, when Caesar was celebrating his four triumphs, one for each territory he fought in, Gaul, Egypt, Pontus, and Africa, the Romans had taken offense at the inclusion in the fourth triumph of painted scenes depicting the suicide of important Romans. Appian writes, "Although he took care not to inscribe any Roman names in his triumph, as it would have been unseemly in his eyes and base and inauspicious in those of the Roman people to triumph over fellow citizens." Yet all these misfortunes were represented in the processions and the men also by various images and pictures, all except Pompey, whom alone he did not venture to exhibit, since he was still greatly regretted by all. The people, although restrained by fear, groaned over the domestic ills, especially when they saw the picture of Lucius Scipio, the general-in-chief, wounded in the breast by his own hand, casting himself into the sea, and Petreius committing self-destruction at the banquet, and Cato torn apart by himself like a wild beast. Cicero thought Caesar's work, Anticato, was harsh and sought about copying it and distributing it in the hopes that it would boost Cato's memory and reputation rather than ruin it. In the face of Caesar, Cato became a constant reminder, a weapon by the people and prominent men, that Cato was a loved Roman and was not forgotten. Both he and Cato became archetypes of opposing political principles, and this became clear under Sallust, a contemporary, who puts them as oppositional figures in his work on the Catiline Conspiracy. Sallust claims that Cato and Caesar were equals, and Cato will continue to be recasted and shaped throughout the centuries. Caesar Augustus will recast Cato's legacy to legitimize his own domination of the Roman Empire in a veil of Catonian republicanism, and once Augustus gave the okay to praise Cato, other Augustan authors followed suit. And now I leave you with a quote from Virgil's Aeneid. "But far from these the artificial divine had wrought a Tartarus, the dreadful doors of Pluto, and the chastisements of sin. Swung o'er a threatening precipice was seen thy trembling form. O Catiline, in fear of fiery faces nigh, and distant far the assemblies of the righteous, in whose midst was Cato, giving judgment and decree." And that is the end of the life of Cato the Younger. Thank you for watching, and Wale.